Today's session is going to be consecrated to talk about the peace process in Colombia. I'm going to introduce my our host for tonight later on, but just to give you a brief summary about the issue. On November 24th, 2016, the Colombian government and the Revolutionary Armed Forces of Colombia, the FARC, signed a peace agreement aiming to end the 50-year-long war between the government and the FARC, a war that has left more than 200,000 people dead and more than 8 million displaced in Colombia. The agreement was reached after efforts from the current Colombian president, Juan Manuel Santos, who was awarded in October the Nobel Peace Prize for his efforts in that regard. The talks began 4 years ago in Havana, Cuba, in 2012, and eventually led to the agreement at the beginning of fall 2016. I remember when I visited Colombia a few months ago, and I remember the day I arrived to Colombia was the day the peace agreement was, it was declared that they had reached a peace agreement. And the spirit in Bogota that day was amazing, really, because everybody was really excited about the peace agreement that was reached. And people at the Dejusticia were excited as well. We were excited. And I was looking at on Twitter and on the news to see what were the reactions back then. So most people that I read were really excited about it, but some also had a few reservations because they were afraid that the peace agreement would transform into an amnesty law. And once I read amnesty law, I couldn't help but draw the parallel between what was happening in Colombia in 2016 and what happened in post-Civil War Lebanon after amnesty laws were issued by the parliament and their dire consequences to transitional justice. Indeed, a first version of the agreement was actually rejected on October 2nd, 2016 by referendum, and it was only a revised version of the agreement that was later ratified and voted by Congress on November 24th. No referendum this time. So what we need to look into in this session are the steps that were undertaken to reach that agreement, of course, how it was received by Colombian society, especially after the second version was signed. Why was it rejected? What were the factors of its rejection the first time by referendum? What contributed to that failure with the public? And what does the new version, revised version, entail, especially in terms of transitional justice? To talk about this really big issue, I am very happy to introduce a fellow researcher and activist and a professor, Cesar Rodriguez Garavito, who is the executive director of the Center for Law, Justice, and Society, Dejusticia, which is written Dejusticia for people who do not speak Spanish. He is an associate and founder of the Program on Global Justice and Human Rights at the University of the Andes in Colombia. He has been a visiting professor at Stanford University, at Brown University, and at the University of Pretoria in South Africa. He also founded the Human Rights Lab. His publications include Racial Deprivation on Trial, The Impact of Judicial Activism on Socioeconomic Rights in the Global South, and something I had the pleasure to read, Amphibious Sociology, Action Research for a Multimedia World. Cesar, the floor is yours. After his presentation, we can go into the Q&A.
Thank you, Karim. Thank you, Karim. And I wanted to begin by thanking AUB, the Legal Agenda, Karim, Nizar, and also the FOR Foundation for having made this occasion possible. And for us at the Justicia, and for me personally, this is a special occasion on many counts. First of all, because I never dreamt of ever speaking about peace in Colombia in my lifetime. I thought that this time, this day would not come, that the end of a 52-year war would never come. So the fact that I'm invited by friends to talk about the lessons from the transition to peace in and of itself is, for any Colombian of my generation or previous generations, quite a special occasion. And you may have heard, this is the oldest civil war in the world. not necessarily the bloodiest. It did the count of assassinations and deaths from the Colombian civil war hovers around 220,000 direct victims of assassinations. But we, over the decades, accumulated such humanitarian emergencies and so many family and personal tragedies that it's difficult to encapsulate this in half an hour. But certainly from a lived experience, I grew up in the times of the car bombs in downtown Bogota. You may have heard about Pablo Escobar. I see that we have a relatively young crowd, so you may have seen or heard about Pablo Escobar from the TV series now, you know, what are they called?
Narcos,
exactly, Narcos. And there's a very good one that's Colombian made. It's called Pablo Escobar, the boss of evil, something like that, el patrón del mal. That's a particularly recommended one because the Colombian actor who plays Pablo Escobar basically became Pablo Escobar, and he became a really, really tough guy because he really got into the character. But that's great. It's great that now we can talk about those days as if they were a TV series, right? Just as the US is speaking about its own reality as if it were a soap opera, we look back to those days with fear, and this is the second reason why this is a special occasion for me. Many of the signs that I pick up on the street here in Beirut make me think of home. The good and the bad signs, the military presence and the security measures and the combination of places like this wonderful building and this university combined with informal housing and inequality and violence. So that all of that mix is quite close to us, quite familiar to me, even if I'm many thousands of miles away from home. And finally, it's a special occasion because, of course, Lebanon went through the process that Karim described of transitional justice in its own way that led to some lessons. And we in Colombia went through our own recent process of transitional justice that will yield some international lessons that I would be very happy to share with you in a nutshell. But really, this is an open-ended question. No, there's no perfect answer for transitional justice. This is one thing that everything that I'm going to tell you about, it's our imperfect effort at reaching an necessarily imperfect compromise between peace and justice and guarantees for non-recurrence and compensations for victims. So what I thought in order to make this story, which could take us many days to tell, digestible and amenable to a non-Colombian crowd, is that I would use the word in my subtitle there, or my title there, good news from an unlikely place. I already said why this was unlikely, coming from Colombia. But I'll pick up on the news part of this, and I'm gonna use some, does anyone know who this person is? Not the one to the left. The one to the right is some king, but it doesn't really matter. But the one who was really bright and did something big for the history. This is Gabriel Garcia Marquez, the Colombian Nobel Prize in Literature from 1982. By far one of the greatest writers of all history in Spanish and maybe in any language. And he wrote a lot about violence in Colombia. So if anyone were to ask me, well, what should I read to know more about violence in Colombia? I would advise that you read some of his work because he created a magical fictional world out of the sheer reality of violence and inequality in Colombia. His brand of literature is called magical realism for that reason. And he wrote this wonderful book entitled News of a Kidnapping. This is not a work of fiction, but this is a work of journalism. He started off his career as a journalist in the Colombian newspaper that I now am honored to write an op-ed for, El Espectador. And he wrote this journalistic account of a very famous kidnapping that was perpetrated by the drug gangs, Pablo Escobar, basically, in the late 1980s and 1990s, a wave of kidnappings that were politically motivated. Basically, what the drug lords back then wanted to get the government to do was to not extradite them to the US, not to send them off to jails in the US. And that's just one ingredient of the Colombian armed conflict, or the Colombian violence. It actually fed into political violence, but I won't get into that. But García Márquez wrote this, book that brings together several strands of the history of violence in Colombia. And this also, because this is the more recent picture from December of last year, this is President Juan Manuel Santos at the moment where he received the Nobel Peace Prize in early December of last year. So this is with a difference of 34 years or two Nobel Prizes, in a way encapsulate the history that I'm going to try to tell you in a nutshell. And to do that and to give the presentation some clear structure, I divided it into three parts. First, I'll say something about the war, because for those of you who are not familiar with the Colombian reality, it is important for you to know a few particular facts and a few singularities about the Colombian war that explain the complications, but also the achievements of our own transitional justice process. Second, I'll focus on telling you about the peace agreement, the peace process, including the transitional justice deal. And finally, I'll end with a very short note on the challenges going forward. Because as you may have read in the literature on conflict resolution, it is one thing to make peace, and it is a different thing to build peace. So you, for example, in Lebanon and many other countries, you may have reached peace, you may have ended the war, but building peace, restructuring institutions, addressing the grievances behind the violence may not be as successful as reaching a peace agreement. So this may be a long-term and even more difficult task than reaching a peace deal. So about the war, again, I'll just use García Márquez and pictures throughout so that you get a sense of, a more vivid sense of what I'm talking about. This is García Márquez in a speech he gave in 1994. He said that we have talking about Colombians, right? We have an almost irrational love for life, but we kill each other out of our deep eagerness to live. That was his effort at capturing the irrationality, the lack of rationale of the violence in Colombia. The lack in that Colombia has no religious sectarian violence. It's a highly homogeneous, relative to Lebanon, I guess everyone else in the world is quite homogeneous, right, in many terms. But we all speak the same language, although there are indigenous peoples who speak several languages. It's one official language. Relatively religious homogeneity, some regional differences, but our war was not ethnically or religiously motivated, right? So one of the persistent questions among social science in Colombia is, why are we killing each other, right? What is it that makes our war so long-standing, so stubborn, right? And there are, of course, alternative theories about this. The most plausible one, the one that I think is strongest, is the fact that the Colombian political system has always been quite narrow and has never tolerated alternative parties outside of the mainstream, right? So whenever a populist figure or a too progressive, too conservative figure would arise, he would be killed. Right, so many of our political leaders, including what our own Perón, our populist political candidate, presidential candidate in 1948, was killed on the streets of Bogota, and that was the spark that triggered the long-standing violence, the period known as the violence, in 1948. But the war that officially came to an end in November of last year really started in 1964. And so these are images from FARC, the Revolutionary Armed Forces of Colombia, the oldest guerrilla in the world that, as we speak, is turning into a political party, right? They were established in 1964 as liberal guerrillas, basically self-defense units, trying to fend off attacks from conservative gangs. Long story short, they grew exponentially in the 1980s and 1990s, partly because of funding from the drug business, which of course complicated the geopolitical picture because the US got actively involved in cracking down on the guerrillas through the Colombian army. But if the picture were so clear cut, this would not be Colombia. This is the right wing response to the guerrilla movement. This is a commander of the paramilitary right wing squads that were bankrolled by some large landowners and some political figures. This is and that put an end to the guerrilla expansion in some places of Colombia by fostering a highly violent counterinsurgency. Right, so many of the communities that I work with these days were as victimized by FARC as they were by the paramilitaries. So many of the most awful massacres that happened in the 1990s and early 2000s took place in those regions in of Colombia where the paramilitaries and the guerrilla were fighting over territorial control, right, on the Pacific. I'll show you a little map of Colombia in a moment, but those, this is the violence, illegal violence on the two sides of the political spectrum. And of course, the Colombian military was heavily involved throughout, and in the late 1990s and early 2000s, got a big boost from US military aid. So when I see what's going on in Egypt and the fact that we always vied and competed with Egypt for the, second place in US military aid after Israel, right? Because Colombia has always been that type of ally of the region for the US. And the Plan Colombia, which was kind of a concerted effort of the US to support the Colombian military in the 1990s, in 2000s, became a key factor in the Colombia, the recent phase of the Colombia war. Final two factors, I promise I could go on and on because it's a complicated war. But two key factors explain some of the particularities of the Colombian process and peace process. This is the first one, the drug business. So Colombia used to be the headquarters of the drug business, as you may have heard. Still, when I get a lot of when I travel around the world and people have not read the news for the last 15 years, they say, well, you come in Colombia, so you have any cocaine around? So I say, yeah, but you have to go to Mexico for that because they took their business away from us, right? So they basically, so that central role that Colombia used to have, unfortunately for the Mexicans, because I know what it is to live in a society where that's where the center of the drug business feels, is like the Mexicans took away control of the most profitable segments of that market, whereas the Colombians are now the producers and the Mexicans are the traders, right? The ones who actually trade with the cocaine. But back then, in the 1980s, 1990s, it was the Colombian cartels, drug cartels. So that the association, gradual association of the FARC guerrilla with the drug trade, basically by imposing a tax, what they would call a tax, but it was really kind of a blackmailing the small producers of coca leaves and getting involved in the drug business, led to two things. One, to the considerable expansion of the guerrilla groups because they had much more resources now. And second, to the depoliticization or the winning of the more drug-oriented and trade-oriented and militaristic wing of the guerrilla movement over the more political factions of the guerrilla movement. So back in the 1960s, 1970s, the Colombian guerrillas were heavily ideological. They had a clear ideological agenda. But then in the 1980s, 1990s, the picture got much more complicated because of the corruption coming from the drug business. So this is one thing. And finally, this is the recent environmental impact of the war. So illegal mining also became a source of resources for the guerrilla movement. And this is all because, as I'll show you in a moment in the map of Colombia, Colombia is, as many countries in the global south, is a very unequal, segmented country. You can have, and very much like Lebanon, but Lebanon, of course, at a smaller scale, geographically, you have some spaces, cities, regions that look just like the first world, right? Just like downtown Lebanon here. But you can also go to shanty towns here, and you can also go to places, peripheral regions of Colombia that look pretty much like sub-Saharan Africa. So it was in those places, the sub-Saharan Africa-like places, where most of the violence and the war was took place. And that helps explain, I'll pick up on this point when I talk about the referendum results, because the violence did not take place mostly, the guerrilla and the paramilitary violence did not take place mostly in the urban centers, but in the rural periphery, which means that most of the voters never got to taste the worst of violence. Thankfully, that's a good thing. But it also makes for a highly skewed view of the war, in which the urbanites, who are the majority of the country, vote on the end or the continuation of a war that affects mostly those who are in the minority and have been living forever in those regional, rural regions of Colombia that have borne most of the burden of the war. And with that, let me transition to what's happened more recently and with the peace agreement. So this is a map of Colombia. Basically, up here, sorry, up to the north is the Caribbean Sea. To the west is the Pacific Ocean. So this is the upper, the northernmost corner of South America, right? So that, and to the south is Peru, Bolivia, and Brazil. So it's the Amazon region. And what we see is that, and I'll show you quickly some of the effects of the war. This is a picture that won a prize of a competition that we organized at the Dejusticia project. 5 million people were forcibly displaced. So this is another infamous record that we set. So we were always vying with Sudan at one point, and then Syria at a more recent point, for the infamous record being the country with the highest count of IDPs in the world. So around 5 million people were forcibly displaced. And this is a moment, this is a picture of a moment in which a father is fleeing his town while someone else is picking up a corpse and carrying a coffin because a massacre had just happened. This is another picture from a particularly vicious attack of FARC, and the upper, the previous picture is, this is violence caused by the paramilitary squads. This is of the FARC on the Pacific coast. And this this is one of the most spectacular attacks in a social club in Bogota, one of the few very visible ones that they perpetrated in a major city. And this, I'm transitioning towards the peace moment with this picture of former President Álvaro Uribe, who was president of Colombia between 2002 and 2010. He won, he was in many ways a predecessor of the populist kind of iron fist type of policies that we're seeing now around the world with Duterte in the Philippines, Erdogan in Turkey, you know, even Trump in the US, and so on and so forth. He won in 2002 as a maverick, as someone who ran outside of the political parties, even though he had been part of one, promising that he would defeat FARC. and you could not be and you could not get a more popular platform to get into the presidential office than that at that point. And this came at a moment when, right after the FARC had engaged in a failed negotiation with the previous government, I had basically betrayed the government, the previous government, because FARC were never serious about that peace attempt. So they were completely discredited before public opinion. And riding on that discontent, Álvaro Uribe got into power. And he heavily with the help of the Plan Colombia, the U.S. Aid, military aid, he was quite effective at cracking down on the FARC. So even if I disagree with many of his policies to this day, but the point has to be granted that he, in military terms, he turned the tables, and he managed to corner the FARC. And at that moment, current President Santos, the Nobel Peace Prize, he worked for Uribe as his Minister of Defense, right? So that's the setup back then. And this is, so there was a turning point in which the FARC were heavily hit. Some of their commanders were killed, and everyone was put on the run. And this leads us finally to the final ingredient in this complicated but interesting case of transitional justice, which is that Colombia was never a failed state. Right? So you, this all took place, all the images of violence that I have shared with you, all took place against the background of a highly independent judicial power, against the background of a highly progressive constitution in 1991. Colombia is a very legalistic country with relatively strong institutions for a global South country that survived and continues to survive with this kind of schizophrenia. Strong institutions at the center, cities, the more well-to-do classes and so on, coexisting with very precarious institutions and marginalized populations in the periphery, right? And this is the Constitutional Court, which is a very famous, internationally famous court for its progressiveness and independence. They were the ones who, in 2010, stopped President Uribe from running a second time for re-election. If this, when I see Turkey these days, that reminds me of what happened in 2010. When Uribe tried to pull off, it's exactly what Erdogan is trying to pull off these days. Reform the constitution slowly but surely until you dismantle all checks and balances. So thanks to the Colombian Constitutional Court, we're not Turkey these days. Finally, this is a picture from an attack on the Supreme Court back in the 1980s, in which another guerrilla group tried to seize the Supreme Court, and as a result of the counteroffensive of the military, most of the justices of that Supreme Court got killed. So with all those moments of transition, and of suffering, but also of resilience of the institutions, we have the Colombian paradox. This has been called as such by social scientists. The paradox of a country with strong institutions and with strong institutions and relatively stable economy, by any standard, certainly by Latin American standards, coexisting side by side with this unacceptable levels of violence and suffering. I close this section with, again, a quote from the same speech by Gabriel Garcia Marquez. He said in that speech, "We are fanatic legalists, but we also carry within our souls a master lawyer that circumvents the law without breaking it." So it's even the peace accord, it's 300 pages long. If you read it, it reads like a highly sophisticated piece of legal craftsmanship, right? There's a running joke, Colombians, we've survived the war also with humor. I don't know how you did it here and how you've done it, but we make fun of ourselves even in a very cruel way sometimes, but we, in order to survive, we develop this dark sense of humor. And we said that, some people say that in the end, the FARC turned out to be not so, it doesn't translate well, but not so revolutionary, but mostly legalistic. It doesn't translate well, but they were the ones who insisted on the more kind of painstaking issues in the peace accord. They would argue over the clause 1.2 being in accordance with point with the preamble, and the preamble being legally coherent with the third chapter of the agreement, and so on. So this permeates the making of peace. So I'll spend the rest of my presentation on this. But it was impossible to understand the particular features of the peacemaking process and of the peace agreement without having at least the basics of the conflict. So there's four features that I would like to highlight and for you to bear in mind, and we discuss what happened in the peacemaking process. Because these are particularities, things that stand out vis-a-vis the history of transitional justice. Transitional justice in the world has had two international moments, right, that they were quite influential. The Nuremberg moment in 1945, that we all know, when some of the perpetrators of the genocide and some of the perpetrators of the worst atrocities in the Second World War were brought to court in Nuremberg. Then the second wave took place in Latin America, in the Southern Cone, Argentina and Chile. This is when the idea of transitional justice and the name of transitional justice were created. Right? And still the Argentinians are struggling with the human rights violations from way back, from the late 1970s, early 1980s. But the key thing to bear in mind here is that these were transitions away from dictatorships, in which the main perpetrators that had to be brought to justice were former presidents and former junta leaders, former cabinet ministers. So it was transitional justice vis-a-vis the state, an illegal authoritarian state that has to be, whose leaders had to be brought to justice. We didn't have anything like that. As I said, Colombia has been the most stable democracy in Latin America. We only had 4 years of military rule. You know, when Brazil had over a decade, Argentina had different relapses into dictatorships, and some countries spent most of the 20th century under authoritarian governments in Latin America. So this is a transition within a stable democracy, in which, and this is a key part of it, in which the state was not the only perpetrator. Of course, military personnel committed abuses, but they were not the only, and not even the main perpetrators, right? Depending on how you count and exactly what human rights violations you focus on, the paramilitary squads, for instance, were responsible for the majority of IDPs. The guerrillas were responsible for the majority of kidnappings, and everyone contributed, the right-wing paramilitary squads and the guerrilla, to assassinations and, for example, to recruitment of underage soldiers. So the key, the challenge for us was, well, how do you make a transition to peace when you have to bring to justice or to make accountable all those different sectors of the population and the state? Because if you just focused, as the right-wingers wanted the process to be, they wanted the whole process to be about the FARC. Right? So Uribe said, well, this is a negotiation with FARC. So why are we talking about the responsibility of the military? Why are we talking about the responsibility of business people who bankrolled different factions in the war? And the response of the government, I think that is the right one, and also of FARC, as it happened, is, well, this is, the Colombian war was multi-sided. Why bring justice, why make accountable only one faction in that war, right? So, and everyone, all of those actors, victimized civil society. So it's not like one, they only perpetrated abuses against each other, but they all affected the civil population, the Colombian citizens. Key factor, this is the first large transitional justice process that takes place after the Rome Statute, after the establishment of the International Criminal Court. So in 1998. So the question is, Colombia could not have had the South African model, right? So everyone, as you may have heard, so South African Peace and Reconciliation Commission, the Truth Commission, the Truth and Reconciliation Commission, and the more kind of consensus-oriented, reconciliation-oriented type of transitional justice was not possible in Colombia. Because we had to respect the international guidelines of the Rome Statute, which basically say that you have to bring some measure of justice, right? And what justice means is perhaps the most contentious issue in this type of debate. And I'll refer to that in a moment. But it was impossible for the Colombian government and FARC to negotiate a blank amnesty. Blank amnesties are forbidden. Now, what the punishment is flexible, unlike what the opposition to the peace agreement used to say, and even organizations like Human Rights Watch, but a blank amnesty for everyone, forgive and forget, was impossible. So this is a particularly challenging scenario in which you need to move to a situation which you have to convince, and this is the fourth factor, the guerrilla was weakened but not defeated. So many of the strong critics of the peace deal and of the peace negotiation wanted the government to basically to impose draconian conditions, like really harsh conditions on the guerrilla. But it so happens that the guerrilla was still active and it had not been militarily defeated. It had been heavily weakened, but this was still a political and military negotiation, right? So as you transition toward, if you're a government or a civil society organization trying to work for peace in Colombia, you had to square this difficult circle, right, of juggling these four different considerations. I won't go into details here because Karim already nicely summarized the process. This is the moment of the opening of the process in 2012 in Oslo. This is a moment of one key feature that I want to highlight here is that some social movements were quite effective in participating and influencing the peace deals. This is especially the feminist movement, the women's movement. So they did get gender language in the agreement, and they were quite effective in singling out the particular ways in which women had been victimized in the war. For example, by being victims of sexual violence as a war strategy. This is the picture from last year, the day of the first agreement in Havana. This is Raul Castro at the center. It all took place in Havana. And the FARC commander and President Santos. And then this was the unexpected turning point. Everyone, both on the right and the left, and at the center, above, below, everyone was expecting the yes vote to win. All the polls said that the win vote would win with a majority of 60% of the votes, and that was the most pessimistic count. As we said the day after, the yes voters and those organizations like my own organization, Dejusticia, we did not have a plan B for after the vote. But the opposition had no plan A because they thought, and they had gone to court actually to sue the government for having called the referendum because they were sure that they would lose it. And lo and behold, the no vote wins by 50,000 votes. Right, it's 50,000 votes. So basically, the Colombian electorate was split into two halves. We have roughly 6 million people voted yes, 6,000 and 50,000 people voted no. So what do you do when you've worked for a peace process for 4 years? that's bringing the oldest war in the world to an end, and you put it to a vote, and the majority of the voters say no. And this came, you know, in the this came not long after Brexit, so it also raised all kinds of issues about referenda, right? Are they reliable ways of deciding these momentous and the historical issues? There's historical abstention. So voter turnout is around 40% always in Colombia. And it was this way as well on October the 2nd of last year on the referendum. So 40% of the Colombian adult population voted, 60% said nothing. Right, and the 40% gets split into two halves. Second complication, I told you this is complicated. Most of the areas where victims, current victims of the war are concentrated, voted heavily for the agreement. So they voted yes. But the enough urban voters were inclined to vote no, even though they had not suffered most of the violence, right? So what do you do? Does each vote count equally? Yeah, sure, it counts equally. But we were at a huge national impasse after October the 2nd. And this is partly because, and this is, of course, this is not the day of the referendum. People would not be that happy, and especially the president and the president of Congress. But this is partly, I'm trying to give a rationale, some of the reasons why the no vote won. One is that this is actually what they have in their hands is the physical object, the text of the agreement, 300 pages. So it's really difficult to convey accurately, even a summary version of a 300 pages agreement, right? Complicated, which is not the agreement, by the way, was not only about transitional justice, but it includes a chapter on land reform, second chapter on political participation, third chapter on drug policy, fourth on the integration of the guerrilla into Colombian politics, fifth on transitional justice, and sixth on the process of giving up weapons and actually demobilizing. So that was one factor. Definitely people, as we know from political scientists around the world who have reflected on the Brexit results and on the Colombia referendum results, people on referenda tend to vote on something completely different from what they're asked. Right, so they tend to vote yes or no depending on whether they like the person who convenes to calls for the referendum. Right, this was a referendum inevitably over President Santos. Santos is hugely unpopular. He's not a very charismatic person, and Uribe continues to be quite influential. So if it was a popularity test, definitely Uribe was at an advantage. People also, and this is, we will never know why people voted no by a slim majority, because other factors played a role. A lot of lies were told, so this is also the post-truth world. Also in Colombia, a lot of lies were spread around by the opposition to the government and to the agreement. So for example, people were told, and the chief campaigner for the Uribe party against the agreement, for example, recognized very openly, and he was fired as a result, that they had decided not to explain the agreement to their voters. They said, if we explain the agreement, we'll lose. We'll just make up some facts, right? We'll say to the middle class that this is gonna take away from their taxes. We'll tell the working class that the FARC is getting subsidies that the working class is not getting. And we're going to tell the upper classes that this is the way for Colombia to become a second Venezuela. And we won. He said that. He said that on record. And third factor that made this all complicated and difficult to read is that evangelical churches, conservative evangelical churches, mobilized around the no vote because they thought that all the language about gender equality and LGBT rights and all that was a menace, a threat to their agenda. And they got many of their members to vote no to oppose the what they call the gender ideology component of the agreement. So you see, so people voted for many different reasons. It's hard to tell whether Colombians, as some journalists in, outside of Colombia simplified, they say, well, Colombians rejected the peace agreement. Well, some were rejecting the mention of LGBT population. Some others hated the fact that women popped up too often in the text. Others voted thinking that that this was second Venezuela, and so on and so forth. Right. So, but the fact is that this is the referendum, and this is some young people right after the referendum vote. Right. So. This, many people thought this was game over. And what happened after that, and this is a community that we work with that was this victimized by this particularly vicious attack by FARC on the Pacific coast, and they had decided to forgive. And they had voted overwhelmingly, or they had voted yes overwhelmingly. And this is them after the referendum vote. They say, well, we are not only disappointed, but FARC is going to come back to our region, and we know what war looks like, right? So this was a really difficult impasse. I'm going to fast forward towards the end of my presentation with this picture. This is the second agreement. So in a matter of 6 weeks, the no voters and the yes voters attempted to reach a consensus. Government convened negotiations with the leaders of the no vote, including Uribe. Organizations like Dejusticia also convened discussions with think tanks and NGOs that had opposed the peace agreement, said, okay, can we not come to an agreement? Can we not incorporate some of the criticisms, for instance? One, there were a number of reasonable criticisms. This is an imperfect agreement. So one reasonable and accurate criticism was that that it was not clear, for instance, in the original agreement, what kind of monetary contribution FARC would make to compensate their victims, right? If FARC has, and nobody knows the actual amount, if FARC do still have money from their involvement in drug business or in the illegal mining, should they not use it to compensate their victims financially? Why is it that the state has to foot all the bill of compensations? So that was left very vague in the original agreement, and the government itself and many civil society organizations that had been for the yes vote in the original referendum, like ourselves, said, yes, this is a reasonable objection. Why don't we improve on the previous agreement and do the same with, for example, the conditions under which the military commanders, the ones who were responsible for the worst human rights violations, would be detained. Right? So the government took this effort very seriously, but time was running out because the FARC units around the country had been were concentrated in what were called pre-demobilization camps. And of course, as you know, as we all know, in any armed struggle that ends with a peace agreement, there's always dissident factions. So there was huge, huge danger that dissident factions would get activated and that the FARC commanders would lose control over their army, right? So we were running against time here, and the government tried very hard. They came up with a new agreement in November that they tried to get the opposition to endorse, but the opposition again said no, not on a referendum, but on a closed door negotiation. And this is when the sad reality of political polarization was quite visible. We realized, at least that's my own conclusion, that the opposition, not the average citizen who had objections over the agreement, but the political leaders of the no vote, including Uribe, really they were playing a different game. They were thinking about the 2018 elections, and without FARC, it's hard to tell what they would offer to the electorate. If FARC is not around, and the whole career has been built around anti-terrorism and anti-FARC platform, where if your enemy is gone and you are all about killing your enemy, what are you going to offer? Right, so that was a political factor that played prominently in this negotiation. In the end, the government decided to go ahead with the new agreement and sign it. This is the second signing ceremony. One of the things that happened is that there is like five signing ceremonies, and there's pictures. There's more pictures. I don't want to overwhelm you with pictures, but there was another one in Cartagena. There was a third one in Bogota. But this is the final, very very final one in November 2016 at an old colonial theater or an old theater in downtown Bogota. And government decided to push the agreement through Congress. The government was never required by law or by the Constitution to call a referendum. That was a political move. They thought at the time, we also supported that move. We thought that it was important for the Colombian voters to have a say, right? Because this is such a divisive issue. So calling a referendum was a way to legitimize, to give greater legitimacy and thus resilience, durability to the agreement. But I guess everyone was wrong on their political calculations and the popularity of lack of popularity of President Santos around that time. Second agreement got pushed through Congress according to the Constitution, and now we're in the implementation phase. So as we speak, let me see, and Santos, this is, I don't know, you're used to twists and turns in your own political life, but this comes as close as it gets to not just schizophrenic, but I don't know how many different psychological disorders you can apply to this or twists and turns of history, but the referendum was lost on October the 2nd. Santos gets the Nobel Peace Prize on October the 7th, so 5 days later, right? So you say, well, so it's risky to print. Colombia completely split in two halves. President Santos internationally is a success story, so Santos gets the Nobel Peace Prize. So you say, where do we stand here? But as we speak, this is what's happening. The FARC units are moving to around 20 pre-concentration zones, and where they will effectively give up all the weapons by the middle of the year. So this is, by all for all practical purposes, the end of the war with FARC. There's another smaller guerrilla that's also starting a negotiation process, but the real big threat in Colombia was FARC. I'll end by discussing quickly the terms of the justice component, or the transitional justice component of the agreement, because that's probably particularly relevant to you all, and also it gave rise to a bitter debate in Colombia and elsewhere. So the question is, the classical question is, how do you simultaneously attend to the needs of accountability, of transition to peace, of compensations for victims, and of guarantees that these violations will not recur, will not happen again, right? And the key dyad there is peace versus justice. If you push too much on the justice component of it, and you know this better than we do, or as well as we do, if the government had asked the FARC commanders to accept to spend 25 years in jail, right, in exchange for some sort of political benefits, they'd have said, no way. We can, you know, basically we're pretty old now. So if we're 60 years old, we won't go to jail. We prefer to go back to the mountains where we have power and where we still have some money around. So why make peace? But if you make a transition to peace, if you say, yeah, let's forget about all that and let's make peace and move on, well, there's two issues with that. First, or three issues. One, there's the ethical complication of no accountability at all. Second, there's the legal issue of the Rome Statute, which places limitations. You cannot extend blank amnesty for the most serious crimes. So you cannot just forgive and forget rapes, massacres, recruitment of underage soldiers, assassination that happened outside of combat, and so on and so on. So crimes against humanity and crimes of war. So, and this is where the story, the Colombian story, becomes very relevant, because I'm a strong believer, based on strong evidence, academic and political evidence, that the Colombian compromise is as good as it gets. So I won't bore you with the details. If you have any questions, I can certainly give you more details. But the basics, the basic architecture is such that the foot soldiers get amnesty. Those who did not directly commit the worst crimes, were not responsible for the worst crimes, get amnesty. But those who were responsible for the most serious crimes have to go to trial, have to appear before a special tribunal for peace, and have to appear before a truth commission. So a favorable criminal treatment for them is conditioned on three things: that they tell all the truth, and this is contrasted with the evidence that the state has gathered. Second, that they compensate their victims. And third, that they contribute to guaranteeing that these violations will not happen again. And these are serious conditions, precisely because of the tradition, legalistic and judicial independence tradition. The members of that tribunal, who will be independent from FARC, from the government, and from everyone else, will be quite stringent about those conditions. So this is not a case in which these are pocket magistrates who will sign on whatever the FARC say, or the militaries, or the other factions. So this is one key condition. Second factor, it applies to all actors of the war, not just FARC, but also the military, also the funders of illegal armed groups, so that this is an effort at avoiding the situation that you see these days in Argentina, in which some people got amnesty, some others didn't. It's a different story on many counts. The Argentinian situation, you take a completely different talk to explain the Argentinian situation. But the idea and the purpose is to create a system of justice that avoids recurrence and avoids eternal litigation over responsibility of an armed actor that did not get included in this particular peace deal. And finally, and importantly, the peace deal is not just, as I said, about transitional justice. It is about land reform, drug policy reform, opening up spaces for political participation, so that at least some moderate reforms are made that will hopefully contribute to addressing the underlying causes of continued violence in Colombia. And this takes us, and this was heavily criticized by some international human rights organizations. They said, well, you cannot, the only treatment for guerrillas that would comply with the ICC statute, the Rome Statute, would be one in which the guerrilla commanders spend time in jail. And this is exactly the point that some of the opposition in Colombia to the agreement used to make, even though Uribe had extended quite lenient conditions to the paramilitary squads that got demobilized during his government. So our answer as a political and legal community is no. Even within those parameters, international parameters, there's room for maneuver. There's no one way to administer justice. And you as an international human rights organization can say that you won't accept any compromise because you are comfortably sitting in Washington or in Geneva. But we're the ones who are going through this war, and we know the law, and we know what it says and what it doesn't say. And this is my last García Márquez quote from his Nobel Peace Prize speech. He said, why is the originality so readily granted us in literature, so mistrustfully denied us in our difficult attempts at social change? And this is exactly what happened here. Why is it when Global South legal communities try to attempt a different balance between the very difficult consideration that need to be taken into account in our own processes of legal and social change. Why are they debunked? Why are they put in a straitjacket as if there was one correct answer? And this, I can give you more details, but this gave rise to very heated debates in Colombia and elsewhere. And with that, I won't go into the details of the current moment, but leave it at that and hopefully have time to take some questions and reactions from you all. Thank you.
Thank you, Cesar, for this really wonderful, wonderful presentation, a very comprehensive one. I'm gonna move to the questions. One there, I don't know if we have a microphone. Yes, we do. So we can start with that.
Yeah, thank you very much for that very interesting talk. I was wondering about your remark that you gave at the very beginning of your talk, in which you were speaking about the left-wing and the right-wing associations of the two main parties that were fighting each other. How did that have a place in the war itself and in the peace treaty that was negotiated? And because you said that the political spectrum was quite homogeneous, mm-hmm. So what was the reason for conflict in this regard?
If there's another question right now, I will take it as well. Otherwise, we can move to the answer and then move on to the... It's on Twitter. Okay. Yes. Yes. We have one here. Here.
How did outside forces affect the peace negotiations, say the situation in Venezuela?
Mm-hmm. The same person has another question. Could you please pass him the microphone, because
I have a couple more questions. You mentioned that the opposition in the Congress until the very end actually opposed the peace deal, but the president decided, the government decided to push the law through Congress anyway. So how did it happen that the law passed in the end? Mm. And if I may, and I'm not stealing time from anyone else, I might even pose the last question if I may. You mentioned that the attacks mainly took place in rural areas that were quite poor. So what was the rationale behind that, attacking regions that were apparently not rich of resources and not important institutionally? Why waste resources, time and lives on a region that would not be strategically too important?
Okay, so if there are no more questions for now, do you want to, Paul, do you want to ask, could you just pass the mic, please, for Paul, who wants to ask a question as well? I'm going to let you answer, and then I'll move to the Twitter questions.
Approximative English, Malish. Linked to the last question, you said after the failure of the referendum, the government deals with opposition and called them to say what can we do now and to resolve. Uribe group or no voters accept the way the peace is now, either, or they refuse till now the situation, or they are part of the new compromise or not. Yeah. Mm-hmm. And can we say also that the climate play a role in the win of the no? Because I know that there was a very violent storm in the region supposed to vote C. I think it was a Pacific region or something like that.
Okay, maybe we can start by answering those questions, and then I'll do another round of questions.
Let me answer the factual questions first, quickly. On the Congress vote about the second agreement, the revised agreement, actually the government coalition has the majority in Congress. So the minority is the opposition to the agreement. So it's the political opposition, it's the political majority, but it turned out to be a slim majority in the referendum. Right, so the Uribismo, the former president's right-wing party, has only around 20 senators. So it cannot form any type of majority vis-a-vis the coalition, the government, the current government's coalition. So, and most of the parliamentarians, most of the Congress people were in favor of the peace agreement all along. So that's how it got pushed through Congress, against the opposition of the minority, but with the support of the overwhelming majority of the members of Congress. Second, why the war in the more peripheral and poorest regions? Historically, for reasons having to do with the lack of state presence. So again, this is when I see the reality here in Lebanon, I'm reminded of the reality in Colombia. We also have had states within our state, right? Or outside of the state or within our territory, right? Parallel states. And certainly because of the historic neglect of the state vis-a-vis those peripheral regions, including the Amazon, the Pacific coast, some parts of the north and the east of Colombia, it was relatively easy for armed actors to provide public services and goods that the state was not providing. So one short answer was they provided public goods that the state was not providing. Second, including security. Second, as the extractive economies boomed and the drug business became highly lucrative in Colombia, those regions, especially the Pacific coast, became key transit zones for the drug business, right? So all the Pacific coast, even though it's quite marginalized and poor, is the key route to the Pacific Sea from which the coca paste is exported. So the paramilitaries, the militaries, and the guerrilla would kill each other over the control of those routes. And more recently, and this is why I showed the picture on illegal mining, as the gold mining business and other minerals became quite lucrative, they also wanted to control those resources. So this is the pattern that you see in some part around the world, right? Conflict over wood, over resources of, you know, diamond extraction, gold mining, and so on. So that's why in the periphery of Colombia, there were political and also economic reasons to wage the war. On the Uribe and the opposition's evolution vis-a-vis the new agreement, they continue to be in opposition even to the revamped agreement. The revamped agreement is considerably stronger. The original agreement was quite strong already, quite sophisticated, and I think it's gonna be discussed and studied internationally because it really was a four-year effort by skilled politicians and lawyers to try to make these impossible trade-offs and these compromises in a decent and reasonable way. But the revised agreement is even stronger because it did take into account some reasonable, well-founded objections of the critics of the agreement. Some of which voted yes over those, despite that those objections. But that's when, this is why I said that right at that moment, many of us concluded that there was something else going on with the opposition to the agreement, that it was in the end not just about this agreement, but about the struggle over power in Colombia. So who's going to be in control is being decided over the opposition or the support to this agreement. And we're already starting the presidential cycle, election cycle, running into mid-2018. And many candidates or possible candidates on the right so in their interest, especially the Uribe camp, to oppose unconditionally the peace agreement, because that's their selling point, right? That's what they have to offer. I don't think that this is going to revert the peace agreement. It's going to be impossible to backpedal on it, because by mid-2018, the guerrillas will have demobilized, they will have become a political party. But certainly, it is still popular with many Colombians to say that this agreement was a way to give the country up to FARC, right? To give up the whole country, cede the country to FARC. And so this is why they continue to be in opposition, continue to this day to be in opposition in every way. About the weather, I think it did play a role, but not a decisive role. It was a perfect storm in many ways. It was a storm in the north, it rained all over the country. And one thing that did become clear is that, as in many peripheral areas of many global south countries, voters did not have a way to get to the voting booths if they were not transported by the corrupt politicians who usually take them to the polls, right, to vote for them. But in this particular occasion, there was no reason for them to get them to pay for the gas and to get them to the polls, because they were not winning anything. No one was getting elected. So why take all these members of the peasant communities to the polls, right? So that combined to the weather did play an effect. It was only 50,000 votes, so you could have gone in either direction, and no one knows what could have happened if the weather had been better or there had been better transport. On the outside forces, yes, it was a very important factor. A number of very different governments played a key role. So Venezuela played a key role, facilitation role. Chavez was always in support of the negotiation. He was also a supporter of FARC throughout. But he also, as many as Fidel Castro and Raul Castro, had concluded that the armed way to power was a thing of the past, right? And that they would support a negotiation process, even by hosting it. But on the other hand, because Colombian government, despite what Uribe says, is not by any means a leftist government, this is a center of right government, they also got the support of the US. The US was big time behind the agreement. Chile, which is not exactly also a left-wing government back in when this started with Piñera, and Norway, as you know, the eternal facilitator of peace processes. So and the UN has been heavily behind the agreement. So it's playing a big role in the implementation process. So this was a perfect kind of ensemble of international actors from very different quarters, all in support of the agreement. The question, the problems were inside Colombia, right? So everyone, if world voters would have voted in the referendum, we would have won by a large majority. But it didn't happen, of course. It was Colombians who needed to vote. So this is why we had this dual reality of Santos winning the Nobel Peace Prize in the same week that the referendum, that the peace agreement was rejected in the referendum. And finally, on the left wing versus right wing question, this, as in any war, got much more complicated as time went by. Back in the 1960s, when it all started, the ideological affiliations of the actors at play was quite clear. So the FARC and the other guerrilla movements were clearly part of the Latin American left, right? They were influenced by Cuba. They had a very kind of redistributed agenda, social justice agenda. But then things got more and more complicated as the war wore on, including the reality, the sad reality that I mentioned, which is the involvement of the FARC in the drug business and the kidnapping industry, which ended the popularity, whatever popularity they had, they wasted it, and they basically got everyone but a tiny fraction of the Colombian population against them. And definitely, the Uribe government was very also quite effective at reframing the conflict and showing that the FARC were committing these heinous crimes. So when by the time that the right-wing paramilitary squads were established, there were still these, there was still this distinction between left and right, but you'd start seeing all kinds of unexpected alliances. So some of the former guerrilla members would leave guerrilla and join the paramilitaries, right? Because they had become basically protection rackets for drug dealers. Or you would see some guerrilla groups like FARC killing community leaders from left-wing movements, because all they wanted to do, the FARC, was to control a territory, and they would not tolerate any opposition, any competition over the control of a territory, be it from the left or the right. So that's why we called this war a dirty war, right? Fire was coming from all quarters, and it was difficult and at some point impossible to tell who was killing whom for what reason. And that does not mean that the FARC did not have an ideological agenda, right? They kept that towards the end, until the end, and they made that clear in the negotiation process. So that's why land reform is part of the agreement, and that is why also political participation is also part of the final agreement.
Exactly. Speaking about land reform, I'm going to convey the questions that are coming from Twitter, from Amir Lishani, because this is one of the questions actually he asked, and it was a question I wanted to ask you as well. When it comes to land reforms, how easy will it be for the government to guarantee the right of return to the displaced? Another question of his is, I'm going to keep this one as the last one. Another question is, what could prevent the new FARC political movement from being attacked like it happened with Union Patriotica, knowing that conservatives like Uribe and his government stand against the treaty even after the changes? The last question is, do you think it is possible to have such a treaty in the Middle East? If yes, what is needed? And a question that I think you already answered, but I'm going to ask again. To what extent passing the treaty through the Congress instead of through a referendum reduces the legitimacy and strict application of the treaty for the years to come? Those are the questions. And then I'll add one more question that I wanted to ask you myself.
These are all great questions. By necessity, I'll respond very briefly, but we could spend a lot of time discussing each of these issues. The two challenges that got mentioned, the questions about the actual possibility of the victims of the war, say the IDPs, the internally displaced people, to be able to go back to their lands and to repossess those lands that violent actors, both from different quarters, took away from them. That's an open question, because one thing, again, is to make peace, and another thing is to build peace, to be able to come through in terms of the promises that were made and the commitments that were made in the peace agreement. It all depends on two things, on whether or not the demobilization and the given disarmament processes of FARC is successful. So we're hoping, and I have no reason to doubt, that this is going forward in good faith. But there will always be dissident factions, right? So the dissident factions complemented in a twisted way by the other criminal gangs that are still operating in Colombia, because it's not just the political factions, but loose gangs of drug dealers or illegal miners with power and money. If they fill up that power void that the guerrilla is going to leave, then we're in trouble. Right? It all depends on whether the Colombian state proves effective in doing the things that it never did. Basically, meaning not just providing security in those peripheral regions of the country, but also providing services like justice, health, education, so that there is a more coherent state throughout the country, right? Which monopolizes not just power, but the provision of basic goods and services. That's a big if, It sounds basic, but it doesn't sound basic in a place like Lebanon, because you know what it is, what that challenge is, looks like. But in Colombia, it's never happened. We've never had that kind of state. We've had a very selective, segmented state and society. It's not a matter of resources. Colombia would have the money to do this. It's in economic terms, it's doing relatively well, though it's not booming, but it's not certainly in the middle of a crisis. It's not a matter of a technocratic class knowing what to do, because Colombia has that technocratic class. It's a matter of figuring out how to extend the rule of law and also the rule of justice and of goods and services provision to all of the country. Without that, the displaced and the victims of the war will have a hard time returning to those places, because if they've already migrated to cities, they'll have second and third thoughts about returning to places that they know do not provide those conditions, and in which criminal gangs may be still active and in control. So that issue is getting decided as we speak in each of the regions where FARC used to have control and now are moving away from. Same thing with security for FARC members. So the question is referring to a political movement, political party that FARC created in the 1980s as a kind of a timid attempt at trying to do what they called waging all types of wars. Using all the means of struggle. That's what they used to call it. Legal political party, and at the same time an armed struggle, right, in the guerrilla mold. Virtually all of the members of that party got killed by the military or the paramilitaries back then. So a big ghost hanging over everyone's head in this process was whether or not this would happen again. And there are worrying signs. Some activists around the country have been killed over the last few months. And the key thing and key challenge here is with the government comes through in terms of providing protection for those members, not just of FARC, but of social movements. Right? Because one thing that happens when the war ends is that this bottled up energy of social mobilization bursts into the open, and then people can mobilize peacefully in a way that they did not, they were not able to do during the war. So this is the security challenge, both for the FARC commanders and for the FARC members and the social movement leaders in general. Congress versus referendum. This is a highly contentious issue, one that we're still struggling with. To undo the results of the first referendum was to call a second referendum, right? So only through a referendum would you be able to undo what the damage that was made with the first referendum. I tended to agree with that idea until I realized that it would be politically and empirically unfeasible. Politically, because there was no way in which the no leaders would run an honest campaign in which the second referendum would be about the revised agreement, right? But they would ratchet up their strategies about lying about the referendum and of making it something completely different than voting on the referendum, right? On the revised peace agreement. But second, it also got to a point in which it became quite clear to everyone that there was no time, that time had run out for the FARC commanders to actually come through in terms of their own commitments to ordering and directing the FARC units around the country to give up weapons. If the referendum process would have taken around 6 months. And by the sixth month, it would have been too late, because many of the FARC units would have either gone back to war or completely disintegrated, right? So it was an impossible, tragic case for everyone involved. Those who are for participatory democracy, but also for peace, faced a conundrum. It's impossible to get both in this particular juncture, right? So we dreamed of having it all lined up in October of last year, but the conditions changed, and then the government had to make this tragic decision of going forward with less legitimacy, but with more effectiveness, as opposed to shoot for perfect legitimacy, but maybe end up with no agreement at all and no peace at all. That was it. And about the Middle East, I would like to ask you about that. Is that that's a question that I have about the Middle East. I think there's definitely, and I won't risk, and I won't chance an answer here, but there's definitely lessons and elements of the peace agreement in Colombia that can be potentially useful to other conflicts. Definitely the transitional justice part is quite well crafted. If we had the time to study it in a classroom setting and look at the different compromises and how they line up with the ICC jurisprudence and the Rome Statute and the Inter-American Court's rulings and all that, you'd see that it's a pretty, pretty sophisticated agreement, one that is being looked at with great interest by organizations, say, and even governmental agencies in places like Kenya, right, which is struggling with the issue of transitional justice, or Sri Lanka, right, which is going through their own transition. By no means are we a model to be exported and implemented, but since we had to face these novel challenges, the agreement that resulted from struggling with those challenges might shed some light in situations in which some other peoples and nations have to deal with similar circumstances.
I'm gonna take two final questions. Nisreen, you had a question, but I don't know where the microphone. Maybe you can speak up. Yeah. Can you repeat just on the microphone, because we are also transmitting, so.
So I was saying that I'm interested in the racialized dimension of the war and the peace agreement. Because you were talking about how most of the people who were direct victims of the political violence, they were actually in the ones who voted mostly yes, mm-hmm. and how it's actually in rural areas and not in urban areas. So, but you mentioned also the fact that there's indigenous communities in Colombia. So I'm interested in how if you can say something about the indigenous communities and the Afro-Colombian communities, and how do these play a role, and how are they affected differently?
Okay, there's also Samer who has a question. In the second row above.
Thank you. I would like to ask about legal professionals and the judiciary. How did the judges, normal judges, react to this transitional justice model? Were there any oppositions, debates within the legal community and within the judges' community? I'm thinking here about the Egyptian case where the judiciary opposed any transitional justice vocabulary or ideas, as if like normal judges should judge the cases, mm-hmm. point. So was there any kind of debate in the judiciary about that question?
Mm-hmm. Just add one more question to what Samer asked. I read that the modifications included a prohibition on foreign judges judging alleged crimes committed by the FARC. So it would be interesting to know what's the reason behind this modification, and I'm going to play the devil's advocate here. How would it affect independence, and how would independence of the judiciary be guaranteed from that?
Yeah. All these questions, it seems as if it were a Colombian audience. This is all very directly relevant to the basic questions that we dealt with throughout the process and certainly last year. So on the racial dimension of war, it's a key one, and that was close to my heart and to our heart at Dejusticia, because we've been working with a number of indigenous and Afro-Colombian communities for a long time. And definitely the Colombian war, as any war, has class, ethnic, gender connotations. So the it is not by coincidence that some of the regions of Colombia that were disproportionately affected by the lack of state presence and by political violence were those where the Afro-Colombian population and indigenous populations were heavily continue to be heavily concentrated. So you can see the Colombian periphery partly as the result of the different waves of colonization and conquest in which first the Spanish, then the missionaries, later the extractive industry companies pushed people out to the periphery, right? Further and further, right? And then the commodity boom went after that last periphery and the monocultures and the agriculture based on large land holdings growing one single crop. And the people getting displaced in all those waves were mostly indigenous and Afro-Colombians, right? So the interesting development, and this is where the Colombian paradox comes in, is that those movements are also quite strong and legally and politically sophisticated. And they managed to negotiate what's called an ethnic chapter in the peace agreement. The very last minute, they managed to convince the government and FARC to accept that there would have to be what they call an ethno-racial approach to reparations and justice for victims of those groups. Meaning, for instance, that this is the Bohaya community on the Pacific coast, that part of the reparations that they're asking for is to get the government and FARC to sponsored and guaranteed that there will be a process of exhumation, is that of the bodies, because of the massacres, because they were not properly buried and they were not properly honored according to local traditions, right? So that's one specific example. But a more kind of land-oriented, assets-oriented claim is that Colombian, Afro-Colombian indigenous peoples have, according to the constitution, a right to collective property, right? So as a way for them to maintain their culture and their traditions. So they're asking the government and FARC, and now that's gonna be turned into legislation and constitutional reforms, that those provisions in the 1991 constitution be complied with in those areas of Colombia that have been heavily hit by violence, right? So they basically are asking the government and the FARC to comply with the constitution in the process of transitional justice, because one risk in that process is that since land reform is going to take place, that small landowners, for example, would be allocated small plots in those territories that have been granted to Afro-Colombian indigenous peoples according to the constitution. So, and there's a number of other forms of reparation and compensation that are established in that ethnic chapter. So yes, the war had a racial and ethnic component, and yes, luckily the agreement has a racial and ethnic component. Now, with like with everything else, the question and the challenge is whether that's going to be translated into facts and policies. On the legal profession, that's a great question. So I'll take the bunch of questions on judges and the legal professions. As I said, everyone in Colombia has, as García Márquez says, has an amateur lawyer in his or her soul, right? So even the FARC turned out to be quite legalistic. So they would make arguments based on the law that we lawyers, professional lawyers, thought that they would never make. Let's say we thought that they would be much more oriented toward kind of real politics and all, you know, all facts and all political arguments. But they cared a lot about the law, and they wanted the agreement to be quite consistent in legal terms. Likewise, of course, with the official courts and the judges and the legal professionals. So at every turn, all of the key steps were challenged in court. So we appeared a number of times before the court to argue for and against a law that was facilitating or hindering the peace process, right? We, the legal community, the NGOs, but also the research centers and so on. I'll just give you an example because it really is, I can give you 10 different examples of constitutional court and Supreme Court rulings that sided with one side or another of the legal debate, of the different twists and turns. But on transitional justice, let's focus on transitional justice. The Constitutional Court basically agreed that this balance that had been struck by the peace deal was generally in agreement with the basic contours of the Constitution. Also that the plebiscite itself, calling for a referendum, was constitutional, that had been challenged as well. But more importantly, the example that I want to bring to the table here comes from December 2016. The court was asked to decide on whether or not the implementation process could take place through a fast-track procedure in Congress, because these the constitutional reforms and the legal reforms that implement the agreement are so urgent. For example, extending amnesty to the foot soldiers who otherwise would take off in very different directions, that the government asked Congress to pass a constitutional reform allowing for a one-time exception to regular time frames for constitutional legal reforms because there was an emergency situation. And but since the government and all the supporters of the peace agreement thought that the referendum was going to be approved, that the yes vote would win, to increase the legitimacy of the peace process, they conditioned the government all of those reforms to the vote on the referendum, right? So they could, the fast track process was to be unfolded if and only if there was some sort of popular endorsement of the agreement. The referendum vote went the way that I described, so the yes vote, the no vote won, but the case still reached the Constitutional Court. In December, they had to decide, what do we do? This is a tragic case, right? If we decide that fast-track process a procedure cannot take place because they know one in the referendum, then probably this is the end of the peace process. But if we say yes, then we need to relax somehow the requirement about popular endorsement. We have to interpret what popular endorsement means. Does endorsement by Congress entail or amount to popular endorsement, right? So this is impossible. So if you wanna, take a look at tragic cases in Ronald Dworkin, this famous legal theorist, has this interesting case, interesting term, tragic cases. Cases in which you cannot go right, in which whatever decision you make, you are trampling on someone's rights or you're violating some principle that you hold in high esteem. And the court voted 8-1 to endorse the fast track process, right? With the result that it opened the door for the implementation of the peace deal to the expense somehow of a stringent interpretation of what popular endorsement and legitimacy means, right? So, and this is, and likewise at every turn, but this is what happened in December, and all of the basic questions of rights and politics in Colombia get judicialized at some point. So courts are absolutely central, and the fact that they're independent has prevented us, has kept us from as I said, from authoritarian rule and from other downsides of Colombian politics. Precisely because of that reason, I'm quite optimistic that the Special Tribunal for Peace will be quite independent. It's independent, the fact that judges are independent is part of the Colombian institutional culture. Then this is something that Colombians take for granted, right? And this is something that when you look around in countries around the world, well, we fail to appreciate, many Colombians fail to appreciate that tradition of judicial independence is quite quite exceptional, actually, in at least in the well, in many countries. So the Tribunal for Peace judges will be selected by a panel that basically is made up of people who are beyond any doubt. So the Pope was nominated, right? So you can imagine they said, who is above and beyond all kinds of terrestrial doubts, right? So well, let's ask the Pope. Yeah, so they did ask the Pope, and the Pope said, no way, I don't have time to pick judges of this little tribunal, but really what he said, well, I'm not going to mess into with the political stuff, but it's the European Human Rights Tribunal, the ICTJ, the well-known independent NGO, a consortium of universities, and so on and so forth. You get the point. People and organizations that are beyond any doubt about their impartiality. They pick the judges through a public call for applications, and you have, in order to be selected, you have to meet all the requirements that regular judges need to meet, right? So this is all, again, another good solution that the government and FARC found to a very touchy issue of whether the judges would be accountable to FARC or to government, right? So this is an impartial tribunal. And finally, but the one thing that did get kicked out of the final agreement was the participation of final judges, of foreign judges. That was kind of a nationalistic point on the Colombian judiciary. The Colombian judiciary never liked the fact that the foreign judges could participate in the tribunal. I didn't see any trouble. They were a minority. They were to be a minority of international experts. So I'm not a legal chauvinist. So I didn't see any problem with that. Now, I don't see any major problem with them not participating either, as long as they're independent, as the Colombians are independent. That's the key component. But certainly, if you're interested in transitional justice jurisprudence, wait and see, because this is what Colombian judges and lawyers will be able to create. I think this is tribunal, if it goes as we all expect, will also be setting interesting precedents of applying a highly innovative agreement while trying to strike the same balance that the agreement tried to strike. So this is going to be, the tribunal will be in operation for up to 10 years, and interesting jurisprudence will be coming out, some in most of them without many precedents in any part of the world, because as you know, this is the first transitional justice process in which there will be an independent national tribunal adjudicating over the most serious human rights violations based on a national peace deal. Think about the past transitional justice processes that get kicked around, like South Africa, or the Rwanda or the former Yugoslavia tribunals don't count because they're international tribunals in of a different sort. And this is all post ICC. So expect interesting, innovative jurisprudence coming out of Colombia in the next 10 years.
Great. Thank you, Cesar, for your time and for your presentation. Our time is up. However, for the people who want to review the conference, you can review it on our on the Legal Agenda page on YouTube, because we have registered all. Thank you all for coming, and have a nice evening.
Thank you.